Presbyterian Church in Woodbury. He's joining us this morning. He has degrees from Hampton-Sydney College, the Union Theological Seminary in Virginia, and Pittsburgh Theological Seminary. He's been married to Stacy Lee for 27 years and has two sons, Walter, who's a sophomore at George Mason University, and Ben, who's a freshman at West Deptford High. In his spare time, he enjoys cycling, movies, serving on presbytery committees, and wearing bow ties. So please welcome Reverend Oehler. I don't have any announcements this morning. Are there any out in the congregation? If not, let's listen to the music that Marilyn's prepared.
Thank you.
Please be seated. God of living water, we confess the dryness of our lives.
The brittle words we have thought and spoken, the relationships that are crumbling, the narrow perspective that centers on self, the cracked and jagged edges of our world. Hear our confession, O Christ, and rain down your mercy upon us.
Let us now continue in silent confession. Jesus says, those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give will become in them a spring of living water.
In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
We have come to drink. invite the boys and girls to join me up front. We're going to chat a little bit.
Reading this morning is from the Gospel according to John, chapter 4, verses 1 through 21. Now when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard Jesus is making and baptizing more disciples than John, although it was not Jesus himself but his disciples who baptized, he left Judea and started back to Galilee. But he had to go through Samaria. So he came to a Samaritan city called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired out of his journey, was sitting by the well. It was almost noon. A Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." His disciples had gone to the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria? Jews do not share things in common with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have no bucket, and the well is deep. Where do you get the living water? Are you greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us the well, and with his sons and his flocks drank from it?" Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give you will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I may never be thirsty or have to keep coming here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come back." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying, 'I have no husband,' for you have had 5 husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you say that this place where people must worship is in Jerusalem." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem."
It is a joy and pleasure to be with you on this Sunday morning. I want to say thank you for letting the Church in Woodbury borrow the room for our Stewardship Sunday program today. It's always nice to be with other Presbyterians in other settings. So I'm thankful to be with you and bring greetings from your brothers and sisters at the Presbyterian Church at Woodbury. Let me ask now, we might bow together and join you. Pray with me, please. Most gracious God, prepare our hearts and minds to receive your words by the insight of the Holy Spirit, through Christ our Lord. Amen. If you'd like to follow along, I'm going to continue and finish out the remainder of the 4th chapter of John, beginning with verse 22 all the way through the end, verse 47. Our text continues for this morning. "You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know. For salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming, and now is here, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father seeks
such as these to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming, who is called the Christ. When he calls, he will proclaim all things to us." Jesus said to her, "I am he, the one who is speaking to you." Just then his disciples came. They were astonished that he was speaking with a woman, but no one said, "What do you want?" or "Why are you speaking with her?" Then the woman left her water jar and went back to the city. She said to the people, "Come and see a man who told me everything I have done. He cannot be the Messiah, can he?" They left the city and were on their way to him. Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, "Rabbi, eat something." But he said to them, "I have food to eat that you do not know about." So the disciples said to one another, "Surely no one has brought him something to eat." Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and complete his work. Do you not say 4 months more and then the harvest? But I tell you, Look around you and see how the fields are ripe for harvest. The reaper is already receiving wages and is gathering fruit for eternal life, so that sower reap and reaper reaps may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true, one sows and one reaps. I sent you to reap that which you did not labor. Others have labored and you have entered into their labor. Many Samaritans from that city believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me everything I had ever done. So when Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them. And he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, it is no longer because of what you said that we believe. We have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. My wife's family lives in Williamsburg, Virginia, and so we regularly make the trip down and visit family and friends and go to Colonial Williamsburg. We enjoy seeing all of the historic buildings. We enjoy the grand illumination that takes place every winter. And one of the other great joys is the fireworks display on 4th of July. 1 year while we were there, we were standing with hundreds of our close personal friends waiting for that fireworks display to start over the governor's palace in downtown Williamsburg. As we stood and waited and watched the time, waiting for the appropriate hour, we suddenly looked over, and there to one side in the middle of one of the walkways appeared a gentleman and a 6-foot stepladder. He proceeded to open up his stepladder, step up almost to the top rung, open his Bible, start reading scripture, and then proceeded for the next 25 minutes to preach. I don't remember what he said, but there was a whole lot of this, and a whole lot of that, and some more of this stuff, and you're bad. I'm sure none of you have experienced that from a pulpit before. Certainly not here or in any other Presbyterian church. It just turns some of us the wrong way to have that yelling and screaming and screeching about what we should believe or not believe. We find Jesus taking a very different tact in the way in which he preaches and teaches. Our text for today from the Gospel of John shows Jesus and his disciples traveling from Judea back home to Galilee and its south. It's a long journey, and the text says he had to go through Samaria. But if you look at a map, if you notice a biblical map, you'll notice that most direct route from Judea to Galilee doesn't go to Samaria. It's out of the way. To go to Samaria, you go because you have business, you want to see someone, there's something that you need to do in that community. So Jesus and his disciples are walking. And walking and walking and walking a lot of unnecessary hours, at least maybe according to the disciples. I'm sure the disciples were hoping that they weren't going to have to make the whole trip there. I'm sure the disciples were fussing or complaining. Are we there yet? Are we there yet? Are we there yet? And finally, they arrive. They arrive in Samaria. They arrive at Jacob's well, the text tells us. And it's the middle of the day, so it's hot. And they're hungry and thirsty. Jesus and the rest of the crew is tired. The disciples go to the closest community to purchase food for the group. And Jesus sits by the well in the heat of the midday. And as he sits there, he sees coming towards him a woman approaching the well to get water. And so now, friends, we have an interesting situation. It would have made a first century Jewish reader or hearer of this text very uncomfortable. A nice Jewish boy in Samaria and a Samaritan woman headed his way. Their radar would have gone off. Jesus, get out of there. This Samaritan woman, if you must know, there had been about a 700-year period deep festering hostility between the Jewish folks in that community and the second cousins, the Samaritans. which temple was the right temple to worship in, whose laws were the real laws, which prayer book, which hymn book should we use. Jews and Samaritans had nothing to do with each other. Straight away, each group had excommunicated the other from the one true faith, or at least as the way they saw it. And those years had built that hatred, prejudice, bigotry. Nor would Jews on their way from Judea to Galilee would have gone out of their way, nowhere near. And yet we find Jesus sitting in the middle of that community. It's time, really, he should have gotten up, moved away, avoided having any kind of interaction with that woman. It's got to be uncomfortable for those that are reading this gospel. If Jesus gets close, he could be rendered impure. Again, a woman Samaritan heading towards you, a Jewish man, a rabbi, needs to get the heck out of there. And the law is clear that males, again, rabbis, as Jesus was, are not to have anything to do with other women than their wives in public. It's time for Jesus to move along, find another location to wait for the disciples. But Jesus, in his usual, amazing, wonderful way, does something quite shocking. Those of us that have grown up in the church have read this story over and over, have heard it in vacation Bible schools, maybe small group studies. We know what's going to happen. But Jesus, in his day and time, does an incredibly shocking thing. He asks this woman for a drink of water. And she knows the rules and where they stand, and so she says, "You know better than that. You know you're not supposed to have anything to do with me." And Jesus responds, "If you knew who I was, you would give me a drink, and I would give you living water." And then the conversation takes another odd turn. We're about to find out something about her that makes it all the more urgent that Jesus get out of that place quickly. "Go bring your husband," Jesus says. And she responds, "I have no husband." "You're right," Jesus observes. "You had five husbands, and you're living with a man who is not your husband." And now that conversation in Jesus' day is way, 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 way out of bounds. She's a Samaritan, she's a woman, she's a sinner, according to the rules and regulations of the Jewish community at that point. She's probably why she is coming to the well in the middle of the day instead of the cool of the evening or morning when women normally would go to gather water. She's even an outcast within her own community. But the conversation between Jesus and the woman continues. She more than holds her own. She's not intimidated. She's not afraid. Something very new is going on here. Something important is happening. He has not rejected her. She is guilty of flagrant immorality, and everyone knows it in that day and culture. She's been accustomed to stigma for her behavior, for who she is perceived to be. And she comes to terms with universal rejection day in and day out, even in her own hometown. Here, perhaps for the first time in her life, is a man who doesn't react to her the way other men may have. As a potential partner, or seeing her as a social outcast. This man, Jesus, the Messiah, has neither tried to seduce her or condemn her. He has a genteel conversation with her and accepts her. His most stunning and unexpected experience of her life, I would say. So stunned was this lady that she drops her water jar, leaves it there by the well, and starts to run back to her village to go see her neighbors, to go share this interesting story with ones who would listen. Maybe there were a few. To tell what this amazing man had said to her and what he had promised. Just as that happens, we get Jesus' disciples returning again. They had probably gone to the local Wawa and picked up hoagies. But they were horrified, even with good sandwiches. What are you doing, Jesus? Why are you speaking to her? It was for one of them, I think, that this also was a turning point. A great lesson that the disciples will learn this time and many other times. God so loved the world that he gave his only son, John would later write. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn it, but in order that the world might be saved through him. If there was ever a moment of legitimate, justifiable condemnation, it would be that moment. She was guilty, a sinner. The law allowed three husbands in that day. She had five. And after that, she had simply stopped caring about what folks thought about her and her relationships. Jesus didn't care. He didn't get worried and cranked up about what culture and the world said in that time and place. He did not condemn, but had a conversation about how she might be saved. He wasn't worried about excluding her, but invited her to be included in the community. It wasn't about the judgment, but about redemption. At the end of our text, we have this amazing, wonderful detail. The woman becoming the first evangelist, the first person to share the good news. She probably wouldn't be ordained in most churches. And yet, she doesn't care about that. She probably has given up organized religion long ago. But what she does do, and I hope we might see that in this story, is that she bears eloquent witness to the Lordship of Jesus Christ in a way his own disciples have not yet approached. She runs to her village, a place where she was probably shunned, seeking to tell everyone who will listen about this amazing man who knew everything about her, didn't reject her, didn't condemn her, didn't exclude her. And she asks in the midst of tears running down her face, he cannot be the Messiah, can he? We're left with a question, not a proclamation. A suggestion, not a declaration of theological certainty. But I think for us today, the most amazing thing should be that many Samaritans believed. And that is what we are called to do. To believe, yes, first and foremost, but also to be like that female evangelist. To be involved in intentional, authentic evangelism. We as Presbyterians like big, fancy words, so we've got a wonderful title for this particular mark of vital congregational ministry. Intentional, authentic evangelism. If we boil it down, friends, it's simply this. It's sharing the good news with others, like that woman by the well did. It's authentic. She genuinely wanted to go share what had happened in her life. There is worth to go out and proclaim. It's intentional. She sought out folks who would listen by design. It's not merely an expression of kindness. It's not good moral ethics. Again, it is sharing where God has been in our lives, where we have seen Christ working in small daily ways, maybe in large, major moving ways. How many of you have ever shared your favorite restaurant that you've eaten at? Now, we roll over to Pitman regularly, and Menino's is one of our favorites. Good Eats. We share that information. What book have you read recently that you found wonderful? What about a movie or Netflix series? We share those quickly and easily. The call today is for you and I to be like that woman seeking ways to share what Jesus is doing in our lives. If we believe what we proclaim here as we gather on Sunday mornings, if it is a part of our identity that we have a relationship with Jesus Christ, then we should be excited, thrilled, joyed to share what is going on. I hope that you will take time to consider how you, as a community, as a church, as individuals, might intentionally and authentically be evangelists. Yes, I know in the Presbyterian Church, evangelism is a four-letter word, but we've got to get over it, friends. The good news is that the national average is that only 11% of Americans regularly attend church. Those are recent statistics. That means there's a whole lot of people that need to be invited to come and be involved in a church family. Let us proclaim that good news. Let us share what Christ has done in our lives with the folks here and with the folks outside here. And say, please join us and be part of this church family. Intentional, authentic evangelism. Jesus invited that woman to do it and invites us. Let us, with joy-filled hearts, share what we know is true about our Savior. Let us pray. Eternally gracious Lord, we give thanks for your love and care and guidance. We give thanks that you again and again remind us we are called to share the good news, to care for others, to love. Let us be a community that welcomes, that does not exclude, that allows folks to come and to worship and hear the good news. All this we ask and pray in Jesus Christ's name, and all of God's people said,
Amen.
Stand and join me in the affirmation of some faith as printed in your bulletin. We trust in Jesus Christ,
fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaiming the reign of God, preaching the good news to the poor, and release to the captives, teaching by word and deed, and blessing the children, healing the sick, and binding up.
Referrals to other social service organizations, tutoring for the children, connections to summer camps, parenting classes, and assistance searching for permanent housing. For those of you not familiar with our part in it, during the day, our Family Promise folks either are at school or at work, or they can be in the day center, which is in Glassboro. And then during the evening, they come here to share a meal with us and sleep overnight. So what does it mean to the families? To them, it means everything. It gives them a safe place and the ability to keep their children together. It provides them a way to save money. A lot of times, they lose their housing, and they may also have outstanding utility bills or other expenses, which really impedes them to be able to have the funds to get housing again. It provides them a mailing address for employment or social service applications, and a bus stop for the kids. This year, we'll graduate 17 families, which is awesome, and it's the most that we've had to date. And we can't do that without your willingness to share your time and your talent when we have our hosting weeks. So our next hosting week is on December 12th, and I'll be sending the clipboard around in a week or two. And I'm so grateful for you, all of you, that can help support that important ministry. And just a little side note, their biggest fundraiser is actually tomorrow evening, Taste of South Jersey. So I'm not sure if they have tickets left. They usually do sell out, but if you're interested, see me and we'll see if we have any tickets for you. Thank you.
Good morning. Bobby Wilkins on behalf of the trustees again. Although I'd like to add one thing to what Vicki just said. My husband, Earl Warren, who most of you knew, would come with me when I was feeding the family, Promise Families, and he would sit and have dinner with them, and he was diagnosed with Alzheimer's shortly after the program began. But he would come and sit and talk, he'd play with the kids or talk to the parents, and when we left, he'd always say, and more than once, because with Alzheimer's you say everything more than once, he'd say, I can't imagine what it's like to have to spend a week in this church and a week in that church and a week in another church. He said, thank God that's never been us. So when I would say to him, honey, Tuesday night we're going to feed, he'd say, okay. And I hope any of you who haven't participated in the program, when the sign-up sheet comes around, it really is a worthwhile thing to do. But I'm here to talk about stewardship again. And many, if not most of you, heard me talk last week about biblical stewardship being management of the resources that God has entrusted to us, and about money. This week, let me remind you that stewardship is also about the time and talents with which God has blessed us. This congregation is very fortunate to have many members who spend more hours than we can count volunteering to keep our many programs working. Their unpaid hours keep our building functioning, our missions supported, our children encouraged, our services funded online, our yard landscaped, our technology updated, our records in order, our library fabulous, and much more. I won't name these people because it would take too long and I might leave someone out. But please know that we could not afford to pay them what the value of their services are worth. And for those of you who this giving of your time and talents is what you choose to do and can afford to do, we greatly value all that you contribute. First Presbyterian at Pitman could not function without you. And the donations of food for the Pitman food pantry, meals for our family promise guests, gifts for the angel tree, food for fellowship time, jazz vespers and other events, and other collections throughout the year are greatly appreciated and a major part of our stewardship. But this time of year, when we do our annual stewardship campaign, we are asking for pledges of money for 2020. Last Sunday, Darlene spoke of our third meal program. This week, Vicki talked about Family Promise. The next 2 weeks, we'll hear about two more of the many programs of our outreach. These programs cost money. This building requires resources. We do need to pay our staff, and we must support our Presbytery, Synod, and General Assembly. I ask that you give serious consideration to your pledge for next year. Even a small increase will be appreciated and valued. Pledge cards will be mailed soon. We'll return them on November 17th. Thank you, and see you next week.
Remembering the gift of God's love. Let us offer our gifts to the Lord.
Dear friends, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. Folks will come from east and west and from north and south. All the citizens of God's rule in Christ will feast forever in glory. This is the Lord's table, his dinner party spread across time. And all who are baptized in him, all who trust in him, are invited to this foretaste of the age yet to come. As I say when I lead this sacrament in Woodbury, this is not a Presbyterian table. This is the Lord's table. And again, to invite those who trust and believe in Him are welcome to come. As we prepare together, will you join me in our response prayer of great thanksgiving? Let us bow together in prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise to God.
It is indeed right to give our thanks and praise to you, the God of Abraham and Sarah, Miriam and Moses, Joshua, Deborah, Ruth, David, priests and prophets, Mary, Joseph, Peter and Paul, apostles and martyrs, and ordinary unknown saints.
You are the God of our mothers and fathers, and our children to all generations.
You, everlasting one, made us all. You fashioned us into one people, and continue to love us even when we deny our godly heritage.
Still, you call us home to you, your saints dedicated to your will.
Therefore, we praise you joining our voices with all the people of faith in every time and place, who forever sing to the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed are you, most gracious God, for the gift of your child, our brother Jesus Christ, who lived in accordance with your will to the point of laying down his life for the good news he preached and passed on to us. On the night of his arrest, he taught us how to serve one another in love with a ritual of table fellowship enjoyed by Christians of all times and places.
And so, in remembrance of our Lord Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves with thanksgiving as a living sacrifice.
In union with Christ's offering for us, we live out the mystery of the faith we proclaim.
Christ is alive, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Spirit of the living God, make us one as we partake of these your gifts to us, so we might be in communion with you and one another.
As we pray for us together, may our eyes be open to see your glory. As we lift the cup of salvation, may we be strengthened to follow your way.
Until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast together with all saints at God's great family reunion, keep your church one in service to the world here and now, even as we pray for the world you so love. Speak your peace in the world, where wars rage and violence triumphs. We lift before you our prayers for the health of our nation, that all people may flourish, for the upcoming elections in our country, for all people in positions of power over others' lives. May your will be done. May your kingdom come. We pray for those who grieve, for those who are sick, for those struggling to live the fullness of your resurrection. Send forth comfort as only you can give. Forgive our sin, Lord, as we forgive others, and remember our making. Work with who we are, where we are, to form these clay pots into vessels of living praise, that our lives may participate in the never unending song of the universe raised by all the saints.
Through Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor and praise are yours, Almighty God, now and forevermore. Amen.
As we offer this prayer of thanksgiving, as we prepare to come to the table, let us also take time in silence to pray for those who are part of our extended family. Let us particularly pay attention to those that are listed in our bulletin and those who are on our hearts. Let us again join in prayer. Almighty gracious God, we give thanks for the many blessings. We give thanks that we might take time to lift our prayers to you. As we pray prayers for healing and comfort and hope, prayers of celebration and joy, hear our prayers that have been lifted up. Hear those prayers that we offer in moments of silence like this. Gracious God, allow us to continue to pray without ceasing, and also now to lift up our voices, praying the prayer that our Savior taught his disciples, praying together, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Dear friends, as we gather to celebrate this joyful feast, we are reminded that our Lord and Savior in that upper room with his disciples took bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it and offered it to them, saying, This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Our Lord also on that same night, in that same manner, again after giving thanks, took the cup. And he offered it to them, saying, This is my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Also do this in remembrance of me. Therefore, every time and any time the body of Christ gathers together, we might celebrate this joyful feast, celebrating this bread and this cup, remembering the sacrifice that our Savior made, giving thanks at this meal that we will enjoy together when God's kingdom fully comes. Friends, these are the gifts of God for God's people. Let us, with joyful hearts, celebrate this week. We invite our servers and ushers to come forward.
Thank you.
join me in the prayer after communion. After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude, which no one could remember, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes, with palm branches in their hands, crying out with a loud voice,
"Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb."
And all the angels stood around the throne, and round the elders, and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne, and worshiped God, saying,
"Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen."
Thank you.
called to be evangelists, to go out and share and proclaim the good news. As you prepare to go out in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, blessed by God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. May you go, love, and serve the Lord, sharing that good news all of your days.